I wanted to run a video about caffeine addiction, run a challenge for you here on YouTube to have a bunch of people, including me, not consuming coffee for 1 week. We're going to document how everybody was coping without coffee, if we feel tired, if we feel demotivated, you know, if we are biting our nails, missing for the caffeine shot. Out of my 4 or 5 co-workers, nobody wanted to go ahead. They said, no, we're not gonna quit coffee just for you, just for your stupid video, come on. Which makes me thinking why people are so afraid of quitting caffeine and coffee. Stay around until the very end for a very interesting, mind-bending conclusion. You will see, trust me. If we're just meeting, my name is Tassos Koidis and I'm a food scientist based at Queen's University Belfast here in the UK. In this channel, my aim is to teach you how to improve your everyday food choices and ultimately your health. Subscribe to learn more and let's grow together. Reason number one, habits and social engagement. Habits are very hard to break. Grabbing a cup of coffee before work, making one up just after you arrive in the office, enjoying it soon after lunch to keep you awake, to keep you concentrated in the early afternoon, queuing in your favorite coffee shop to get your usual coffee to go. Also, the need to feel inclusion, to feel accepted in a social setting. Or speaking of teenagers, ordering coffee instead of hot chocolate is a sign at your peers that you are grown up now. You don't want to feel discriminated, to feel disengaged or even stigmatized as immature or freak. Reason number two, preparing it as a ritual and drinking it for convenience and comfort. You are addicted to the smell of freshly ground coffee, to the crema of espresso, to the whoosh of the Greek coffee as it's been prepared and rising in the coffee pot, to the warm touch of the cup, the silky smooth milk taste as your lips break the foam of a cappuccino. Warm, but not too hot. Convenient and comforting. A treat to be enjoyed at key moments during the day. Admit it, it keeps you company in the cold morning. It sets your day up in the right way. You know, the morning routine. Or relaxing in your favorite armchair with a coffee on your hand and your Sunday newspaper on the other. I mean, how can you beat that? Reason number three. You are afraid of missing out a caffeine kick. You are drinking coffee to keep a clear mind, to keep the productivity going. I have heard of the sentence, I'm feeling fresh after drinking coffee, so many times. A coffee after lunch will make you mentally focus to complete the tasks at hand, to field those difficult afternoon emails at your desk, to get you to the end of your working schedule, fight the natural sleep pattern after a heavy lunch. A coffee will even help you staying late at night studying to get your assignments done for the uni or for that early morning presentation that your boss asks you. Hit the like button and if we get 10 likes, I will make a video revealing the best time to drink coffee and stay productive all the way around without sacrificing the quality of your sleep. This is a major issue, especially now that we have increased our screen time dramatically during the pandemic and beyond. Reason number four. You are informed of the withdrawal symptoms. You somehow are aware that the lack of coffee gives you strong headaches, cravings for your coffee dose, loss of concentration. You're just too bothered to pass through this phase, especially without a good reason for it. It is the caffeine that is responsible for this. A tiny molecule in the coffee, probably the world's largest psychoactive drug at the moment that we are all being accustomed to. Me and another 2-3 billion of us who drink coffee daily. And quitting coffee from one day to the next, it will surely affect your nervous system, but there are ways to go about it without experiencing the strong withdrawal symptoms. There are actually good reasons to maybe reduce your caffeine content significantly. If you are interested to see how well we cope with this challenge of interchangeable days of caff and decaf during the week, click at the video on your screens right now. Reason number five, it just tastes great, right? Last but not least, coffee tastes amazing. Of course it does, and I can't believe I missed that in the first place. This is absolutely valid, the flavor. Maybe you're into this more traditional coffee profile, the chocolate, the roasted nuts, the cinnamon, and the dark roasts. Or maybe you are into this fancy floral flavor notes, the medium to light roast. There is no doubt that you are not willing to give up this life's small pleasure. To you, I say, welcome to the club. Now, let me take you to that mind-bending resolution. Of course, we missed the elephant in the room. Decaf coffee. By picking decaf coffee at home, at the coffee shops, at work, even now that is increasingly available, you kind of solve most of your fears, right? Apart from the biological effect of caffeine in our metabolism, at least the rest of the reasons why you would not quit coffee, you would not quit caffeine, can be mediated if we just choose decaf coffee. Coffee with zero or next to zero caffeine, it is more like a brain thing that acts as a barrier. It is in our mind, isn't it? Which leads me to think what our brain does to our food choices and to our perceptions around food. Well, a lot, to be honest. Science suggests that what we eat is dictated by our minds, as much as our stomach. Let's touch on this subject now. Firstly, there's a pattern inside our brain telling us what food means, the roles it plays in our lives, what we like and what we don't like, how much we should be eating, vegetable versus sweet treats, what is the healthy diet, if butter is bad for your heart or not, what is considered a good portion size, where I'm really hungry and when I'm not that hungry. All of this is just triggered by the brain. And of course, getting to coffee, how do I feel about coffee as a habit, as my routine, how do I perceive it as part of my diet and my life? What are the emotions I withhold when I'm drinking coffee, and even with other activities in my day that I have it connected with? Secondly, it is also the external influence that triggers, that the culture around me is kind of forcing me to go with the flow. For example, if you're exposed of combining coffee with a muffin, a treat, which is surely a thing here in the UK, you're most likely going to affect it. If you are in Starbucks or the American-style coffee shops, laid-back drinker in your sofa, you relax for hours in the coffee shop with a triple shot of a coffee drink and your laptop on the side. But if you live for a few years in Italy, say, you might adopt the culture of drinking a quick espresso while standing, with no sofas and a couple of bar stools. That's going to be very difficult and very different as an experience. There is so much we can say for the interplay of food perception in our brains, but for now, let's all consider the role of coffee in our daily lives and how aware we are of its effects, both to our body and to our mind. Follow up with this video over here on health effects of coffee and my coffee playlist for even more content. That is it for now, folks. See you in the next video. Bye!